this morning. I had a great time. I tell you what, I'll confess, I didn't get in until 2 o'clock this morning, and so I was kind of partying all night, sort of, because I was driving all night, the night before even. Nonetheless, I had a lot of time to think, so my sermon actually went long last time, so I'll try to kind of cut to the chase with you all.
You had 4 points, didn't you?
No, I haven't. Yeah, that's right. No, I still had 3 points. It went longer. I love this verse. It says, guard your steps when you go to the house of God. Go near to listen rather than offer the sacrifice of fools who do not know what they do wrong. In other words, it's those who just want to pray a lot and just want to talk a lot instead of being careful, because he says this, do not be quick with your mouth. Do not be hasty in your heart to utter anything before God, because God is in heaven and you are on the earth. So let your words be few. And I thought that was really cool. As I thought about that, I thought, you know, God hears every word we pray. God hears every word we pray. All of our words, so don't let them be hasty. And let them be few. So it's not a matter of how long you pray. It's really more about what you want to say. And it's rather special. So I got to meditate on that this week. And just thinking about that, I want to say this again, because I think there's so much truth to this thought, that prayer is just so special. And you need to remember again that your words, every one of them, he's hearing. And that's why I think that we ought to have it in our mind. We don't need to write it down. We don't need to have it written up there. But enter it, because sometimes words just become meaningless after a while. But if we had it in the front of our building, it just said, enter the worship. And then on our way out, and we had above the door, it just says, enter the worship. That's exciting to me. And so anyway, gosh, that was part of my sermon. All right, let's have a prayer together, okay? Father, I want to thank you for these beautiful people. And I pray, Father, that you will minister to this church. Lord, that you would use this church to be a light. Help us, because we need you. I pray, Father, in this dark time in the world in which we live, I would pray that you would use us to be that light. And I pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen. All right. Well, Galatians 5:22 tells us that the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, and peace. So if you would please stand and sing a Sweet, Sweet Spirit.
Oh,
So please follow me in responsive reading. We are saved by trusting. Trusting means looking forward to get something we don't yet have. For a man who already has something doesn't need to hope or trust that he will get it.
If we must keep trusting God for something that hasn't happened yet, it teaches us to wait patiently and confidently. In the same way, by our faith, the Holy Spirit helps us with our daily problems and in our praying.
We don't even know what we should pray for, nor how to pray as we should. But the Holy Spirit prays for us with such feeling that it cannot be expressed in words.
The Father who knows all hearts knows, of course, what the Spirit is saying as he pleads for us in harmony with God's own will. We know that all that happens to us is working for our good if we love God and are fitting into his plan.
While we're up, why don't we sing Trust and Obey?
Increased, and we thank you for that. And now let us Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you so much for this opportunity to come and worship you in this beautiful church. Yeah. Heavenly Father, we come to you with bowed heads and humbled hearts. And I pray that we will search our heart and make sure that we are worthy of this communion. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for all the blessings that you've given us. The biggest blessing and the greatest blessing is your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Sacrifice on Calvary's cross. Dear Heavenly Father, it's a debt we will never be able to repay. The pain, the suffering, the humility we can only imagine. But because of Him, we are guaranteed life forever. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you and we pray these things in Jesus Christ's most heavenly and precious name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Lord's table.
Yes.
Eucharist, as it is called in the Eastern Orthodox churches, the Orthodox Church, the Catholic Church, the Lutherans, the Presbyterians, and I might be leaving out one or two, but it comes from a Greek word that I can't pronounce. I can't pronounce a lot of those big words, but it means grace, it means thankfulness, it means thanksgiving. I can't think of a better place and a better time to be thankful than on at the table, at the Lord's table in the Lord's house.
Yes.
As a child, when I was real young, I was taught never to pray unless you begin your prayer with thankfulness. So we try to do that. We try to remember that, that we always should thank God for what we have before we start asking for what we would like to have.
Yes.
Those many years ago, Jesus met with his disciples at a Passover meal. And after the meal, as the meal was coming to an end, Jesus took just simple bread from the table. In breaking that bread, he says, "This represents my body. My body is to be broken for you. Take it, eat." And likewise, Jesus took the cup, and after blessing the cup, he said, "This cup represents my blood. My blood is to be shed for you, for the forgiveness of your sin, and for the sins of many others. Take it, drink."
Do something kind of fun here. Be sure and thank everybody that they're helping me out with this, because this was a crazy idea I had, and I encouraged all of them at the last minute to come help me. So,
oh,
Enjoyed that music. Thank you for reading the scriptures as well. He kind of wears all kinds of hats from one to the next. But, as I contemplated the message, I actually began last week in preparation for this week. And we are dealing with an enemy that we can't see. We're dealing with an enemy that we can't see. A lot of in our military over these last 20 years, our men and our women were often around an enemy that they couldn't see. Sometimes they would have a bomb connected to them, and others around them, such as what happened at the Kabul Air Force Base. They didn't know that that particular person was the enemy. I like what Paul Harvey wrote. He actually wrote this, if you'll bring that up for me, Brant. It's back in 1965. He says, if I were the devil, this was Paul Harvey. I know you guys have heard of him before. And now the rest of the story. Well, we're going to be looking at the rest of the story right here. But I mean, if I were the prince of the darkness, I would, of course, want to engulf the whole earth in darkness. I would have a third of its real estate and four-fifths of its population, but I would not be happy until I had seized the ripest apple on the tree. So I should set about however necessary to take over the United States. I would begin with a campaign of whispers. With the wisdom of a serpent, I would whisper to you as I whispered to Eve, do as you please. Do as you please. To the young, I would whisper, the Bible is a myth. I would convince them that God, that man created God, and instead of the other way around, I would confide that it was bad, what is bad is good, and what is good is square. In the years of the young marrieds, I would whisper that work is debasing, that cocktail parties are good for you. I would caution them not to be extreme in religion, in patriotism, in moral conduct. In the old, I would teach to pray. I would teach them to say after me, our Father which art in Washington. If I were the devil, I'd educate authors in how to make lurid literature exciting so that anyone else would appear dull and uninteresting. I'd threaten TV with dirtier movies and vice versa. And then if I were the devil, I'd get organized. I'd infiltrate unions and urge more loafing and less work. Besides, idle hands usually work for me. I'd peddle narcotics to whom I could. I'd sell alcohol to ladies and gentlemen of distinction. And I'd tranquilize the rest with pills. If I were the devil, I would encourage schools to refine young intellects, but neglect to discipline emotions. Let those run wild. I would designate an atheist to front for me before the highest courts in the land, and I would get preachers to say, she's right. With flattery and promises of power, I could get the courts to rule what I construe as against God and inform in favor of pornography, and thus I would evict God from the courthouse. And then from the schoolhouse, and then from the houses of Congress, and then in his own churches, I would substitute psychology for religion. And I would deify science, because that way men would become smart enough to create super weapons, but not wise enough to control them. If I were Satan, I'd make the symbol of Easter an egg, and the symbol of Christmas a bottle. If I were the devil, I would take from those who have, and I would give to those who want it, until I had killed the incentive of the ambitious. And then my police state would force everybody back to work. Then I could separate families, putting children in uniform, women in coal mines, and objectors in the slave camps. In other words, if I were Satan, I'd just keep on doing what he's doing. I don't know about you, but this was written in 1965, and it's rather interesting how insightful Paul Harvey was at that time. You notice several things in the passage that Galen read. I am convinced that the truth for life is in the scriptures. It's not in science unless science recognizes the God, the creator of the world. I recognize that if you are going to be fed in your soul, it's going to be not because of a really good book or because of a really good preacher, but what feeds your soul is always going to be the Word of God. It's always going to be His Word. And in it we find truths. One of them is that the first thing that you could notice in the passage is that there was a person that was demon-possessed with the religious. I'm going to say it again. Jesus just threw out a demon that was at church or at the synagogue. Are you following me? Jesus taught us that Satan will sow people in amongst believers that don't belong to God. calls them tares next to the wheat. Now, I'm not a farmer, but I am told that tares look just like wheat, but aren't. And so what happened was Jesus came in and he began to teach, and they were amazed by him because he taught with such authority. He taught not like they had been hearing before. And he got up and he began to speak to them, and he began to teach them, and he began to show them that Satan was right there in their midst. And they didn't know it. And so, ladies and gentlemen, what we see here is that we are in a battle with an enemy that we can't see. And what we find in Scripture, what he's like is that he came to seek and to devour. The Bible says in Peter chapter 5, that Satan goes about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And you have to understand that that roaring thing is about fear. He wants to bring fear into your life. He wants you to be afraid. He wants you to walk through life afraid of the past, that it might catch up to you. Afraid of the future, because you don't know what's going on, and maybe of something afraid even right now. You see, fear is the opposite of faith. And God says over and over and over again and again and again, when he talked to Joshua in Joshua chapter 1, he said, Joshua, don't be afraid. Why? Because I'm with you. He was about to go and have battles that he had never dreamed about. They were about to go into Canaan. And there he's going to have this battle here and this battle there, and he's going to have battle after battle that he was going to have to deal with. Quite frankly, ladies and gentlemen, the Bible teaches us that our battle is not with flesh and blood, but with spiritual forces and evil of dark places. There in Ephesians chapter 6, it teaches us that. And so what we want to gather here this morning is that wherever the truth is told, such as in the synagogue there and in a church, you can mark it down, Satan is there too. You can. I'll give you another verse to prove that. We can find it in Matthew and Mark and Luke, all three of those books. In Mark chapter 4, verse, I want to say 4, but nonetheless, in Mark chapter 4, what we have is an interpretation that Jesus gives about the seed that is sown. The seed is the word of God. The soil is your heart. And Satan comes, and the first thing that he does, the first work that he has, is to steal the word of God. He wants to distract you. He wants you to distract you from the truth. And so, sometimes in churches, sometimes somebody might come in and they might be upset that I don't have a tie. And I probably need to. My ties are so outdated, and I'm so picky about a tie anyway. And if Ron wears a tie, I'll wear a tie. If Ron starts wearing it, no, I'm just kidding, Ron, I'm just kidding. But you know, somebody might get upset about that and just kind of be focused on that. And they could miss the whole message that was right in front of them, you see. Oh, they might not have, hey, Galen, that was incredible to watch. I love you playing that. You're good on that thing, man. I didn't know that you were good at it. You know, that's phenomenal, man. Now I forgot what I was going to say. Nonetheless, yeah, somebody might not have liked that. They're just still kind of upset that you played it. And I'm not saying anybody here would be, but what I'm saying is sometimes we get distracted by something that has no meaning at all, has no importance at all. And so what he does, so we know for fact that Satan works, and we know for fact that you and I don't have to be afraid of him at all. And one of his great works is that he's a deceiver. He's a deceiver. We find that in a number of passages. We find that in 2 Timothy, I believe it's chapter 4. In the last day, Satan is going to be deceiving people. Deceiving. And you know what is really crazy that I thought about even this week? Is that the Bible says in different places, such as in James chapter 1, that we can deceive ourselves. You know how we deceive ourselves? Keep telling ourselves a non-truth. After a while, you believe it. And so again, what you and I want to do is we want to be so sensitive to the Word of God that we won't be deceived. We want to be so familiar with the Word of God that we can recognize deception. Because Satan is always working. He's always working. And so that's the first thought that I have for you, is just that Satan is wherever truth is being proclaimed. Okay? The second thought that I have for you is that every struggle we will ever have can be overcome in his strength alone. Every struggle that you and I have can be overcome in his strength alone. For example, I mentioned a moment ago, fear. It's one of those things that paralyzes people. Paralyzes them. And they don't know even what to think about what's coming. Or what to, you know. But we find in the scripture that God is so gracious that he told us about our past. He's already told us about our future. He's already told us. You and I can walk and we get to have this confidence and enjoyment about what the future is going to bring. Not hopefully it's going to bring, but you can be so confident that you know from day to day. I'm just saying you can, and if you're not there, I'm just saying that you and I can be there. Where we can't wait for the future rather than dreading the future. Satan would like to paralyze you in your life, what you're doing right now, by bringing the future any fears and bringing them right here. That could paralyze you in your faith. And so, nonetheless, what God wants us to understand, are you ready? He wants you and I to understand that he has power over all of evil that exists. Okay, two ways. We see him right there. He cast out this spirit out of this man. And he even tells the spirit not to say anything. Anywhere he goes, he can cast out a demon. Why? Because he's letting you know, he's wanting you to know that he has the power over all darkness. And then you go to 1 John, I believe it's chapter 4 and verse 4. There we go. That's the verse 4 I was thinking about. In 1 John 4, 4, he says, the greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. Yeah, I mean, I don't know about you, but that's exciting to me. Even if you're in a place right now where you're thinking, where you're looking at your spiritual life, or you're looking at life and there's some fear there, I'm just saying that doesn't have to stay there, not because you need to conjure it up and tell yourself something different, because you don't have to. You just get to look to him, and you can ask him, God, I want you to give me that peace. God, I'm not even sure where you are right now. I'm not even sure if you did hear me pray. I'm not sure about that. That's really okay. You know that? I think the best thing in life, one of the best things about God, is you get to be truthful with him, because he knows everything anyway. So you get to say, God, I don't know if you're hearing my prayers. And what I can say by the authority of Scripture is that every word that you say to him, he hears you. But nonetheless, that's something that you want to discover on your own. But what happens is that every prayer that you and I ever pray, he hears those prayers. As you're looking forward and you're afraid, that's Satan roaring. He's wanting you to be afraid. You notice Jesus wasn't afraid of him at all. He told him what to do at any time. I'm kind of weary of those guys and those girls who speak, and I'm just saying, now look, I might get to heaven and find out I was wrong. And I'm okay with that. But when they start speaking to demons and telling them what to do, I don't know about you. It has to be in his name and not ours. Whatever they're doing. Because I don't have the strength. It's only him. It's always been only him. I encountered a lady at the hospital who was there because of some issues. And I'm convinced, personally, that she had an evil spirit within her. The staff could not control her, and I was asked to come, and I went, and all she was doing was walking just steadily around I think it was the second floor, just walking around, in the circle of the hospital there on the 2 North. And I just, I saw her, and I kind of figured out it was her, and I walked up next to her, and I just began to speak to her. She really didn't want to talk about God at all, and she started off very nice and then became rather hateful. And we continued to walk, and I asked her, and this lady was walking, and I had to stay up with her, you know, and I walked pretty fast. And but I asked her if I could say a prayer with her, and she, of course, refused that. But we continued to walk, and I would share with her a truth or two as we were walking. And nonetheless, she really didn't want me there anymore, and there's no reason to force yourself on somebody. But as we continued to walk, I told her I was going to be praying for her, and she said nothing. But nonetheless, sometimes it's very obvious that Satan is in somebody, and sometimes it's not. But the bottom line is that this Satan, what he's going to do, one of the first things that he's going to do is try to keep you from the truth. I'm going to say that again. One of the first things he's going to do is try to keep you from the truth, and then he's going to give you a lie. And what we find is that's exactly what happened with Eve. Did God really say that? And then he changed the truth a little bit. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know that what we have is a battle with someone we can't see, but nonetheless, we have a God. We have a God who can see it all. He'll walk with us in every struggle that you and I have. How about you? But I would say that I could have like a whole day where there's no struggles whatsoever, and it seems like, man, the rest of my life's going to be just like this. Then tomorrow comes. Right? Then tomorrow comes. And there's something else that pops up. Every struggle we will ever have. Will you bring up there in Ephesians 6, just a couple of verses there for me? Finally, be what? Strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. There it is. What is that? Well, this is what I would encourage you to do. God, I don't know exactly what that means to stand in your strength, but I want you to do it. I don't know exactly what it's going to look like, but I want to stand in your strength. I don't want to stand in my own strength anymore. I don't want to stand in my own wisdom anymore. I don't want to stand in my own thoughts anymore. I want your strength. I want your thoughts to permeate my mind. That's how I want to deal with this, Lord. And so we stand there. But you know what's interesting? After he tells us what we need to do, we need to put on the belt of truth, which is tell the truth. Be acceptable to the truth. But we could go on and on about the belt and the helmet and the shield and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. But it ends with this. It starts off with be strong in the Lord and the might of his power. You know what the last thing he says? Pray. You pray. It doesn't have to be a lot of prayer. It doesn't have to be a lot of words. Like Ecclesiastes 5 says, don't come with me a lot of words. Just know that your words are matter. That your words matter. I mean, it might be that you need to pray for 2 hours. I don't know. I know that people say to me, man, I have my prayers at night. Every night, I don't fail. I have my prayers every night. I'm thinking, man, I don't know how you wait till then. I think it's great that you do. I'm serious. I think it's marvelous. I think that's impressive. Because I don't know your walk. I don't know exactly what your walk looks like. I think that's great. All I can tell you is mine. Mine says, man, I got to pray all day long. And that's how I keep going back. Because I keep, messing up. And I keep needing help. And I keep needing to think right. And all of those things. I'm praying. I got to pray all the time. But that's how he begins. Be strong in his strength. Be strong in his strength. And pray. See, I'm really not an advocate for, just religious prayers, you know what I'm saying, just where you just say the same prayer all the time. I think that that's great. And in fact, I really like it when people write their prayers down. You know that? I think that's really cool. You know why that's cool? It's because they thought about what they wanted to say to God. I think that's really cool. But I just want you to understand that this relationship with him is real. And you don't have to pretend. Sometimes you get up in the morning and say, no, God, I don't really feel like praying today, but I want to. I want to. Let him do that. Watch him. He will work in you, and boy, you'll have a blast. Personally, from in my own experience in life, the most satisfying time of my life is when I pray. Now, I got to tell you, I'm going to be honest. There are times I don't want to pray because my heart is somewhere else, or who knows what's going on, you know. The Bible, Jeremiah, wasn't it? Wasn't it Jeremiah? No, it was Isaiah that said, the heart is deceitful above all things. So I was like, Lord, let me be truthful. Let me be truthful. The last thing that I want to share with you is what I've already alluded to. Okay? I'm going to try to close here. Okay? I'm going to try to close. The only passage I'm going to look at, Brent, there is Psalm 91:1, if you'll bring that up. The third point, and then 91:1, if you don't care. The most valuable moments of your day will always be in the secret place of the Most High. You see, once you've tasted of Him, it's kind of like back in the 80s when they were debating whether God exists. Am I right about that? It seems like it was back in the 80s. They were debating. In fact, it was up at the University of Michigan, I think. And they were debating, and they finally concluded that God was dead. And someone asked Billy Graham, Billy, is God dead? And he said, well, of course not. He's not dead. I talked to him this morning. It was a pretty good statement. But someone else made this statement. It wasn't me. A better statement would be, yes, but did he talk back? Do you hear Him in His Word? Do you hear Him? Do you ever hear Him in your journey? Do you ever experience Him in a way that you can't explain? You can. And it's not because you're bad. It's not because you're bad. It's because it's just how much you want to meet with Him. Just really. It's how badly you want to meet with Him. What does He say in James? Draw near to me, and I'll draw near to you. I think a lot of prayer. I'm going to close here. If you'll bring that Psalm 91:1, thank you very much, Brent, for helping me out. The sweetest experience is just to go and listen. Just go listen. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow. Rest? Yeah. Talk about peace. Talk about your life becoming settled. A hurricane can be going on all around you. I'm just telling you that's true. I didn't say that I always experience it. I'm just telling you that you can. You can have a hurricane going all the way around you, and you can have peace as you dwell. Make a tent. Make a home in the shadow. You know what happened to Job? And I'm going to close. You know what happened to Job? You guys remember what happened to Job? The guy had everything go wrong. Everything that could possibly go wrong went wrong. God had control. Remember that. Always remember that God still had control. But there are two beautiful things that came out of it. Okay? Now, there were probably more, but I'm just going to share with you two that come to my mind. I'm sure there's a lot more. But I want you to know that in Job, we find where he lost his kids. We find that he lost all of his livelihood. We find that he lost his health. Right? Man. I mean, I don't. Oh, wait a minute. I forgot one. He kind of lost his wife. Because his wife said, curse God and die. What? You serious? Watch this. In Psalm 42, these are the things that Job learned. He said this. You ready? He said, God, I'm humbled and I'm repentant. And he says, God, everything that you do is right. That's a big statement. God, everything that you do is right. Watch this. This is so cool. is, God, I used to talk about you. I used to, you know stuff. I knew all kinds of stuff about you. But now I've seen you. Now I've seen you. And so God took those horrible, horrible circumstances and he made something even more beautiful in Job's life. That's what he did. He took a horrible situation and made a better man. You got an enemy. God can tell him to stop at any time he wants to. We have an enemy. But we don't have to be afraid. Let's pray together. Father, I do pray for myself that one is that you'll make me like your son. And I pray this for our church. I guess that one of my prayers would be that you would help us to rest. Not become complacent, more excited. Father, bless this church with peace. A peace that's so rich and so deep that we have to share it with somebody else. Help us. Our bowed eyes are closed, and if God's spoken to you, hey, you know, make sure that you don't leave this place without telling him how you're going to respond to him. We're going to sing together, page
440,
and so if you'll stand with us, and then Paul, if you'll lead us in a prayer as we close.